हेलो डियर स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस क्लास 8 सिविक्स चैप्टर 1 एंड द टाइटल ऑफ द चैप्टर इज द इंडियन कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन। हियर फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई वांट टू टेल यू दैट ट्राई टू वॉच दिस वीडियो टिल एंड, बिकॉज इन द एंड ऑफ दिस वीडियो आई विल टेल यू हाउ यू कैन एंजॉय द एक्टिविटीज विच आई हैव शेयर्ड इन द डिस्क्रिप्शन ऑफ दिस वीडियो। सो लेट्स स्टार्ट। डियर स्टूडेंट्स, वॉट इज कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन? Constitution is the law of the land. We can describe it as that it is a document containing rules and regulations that govern a country. So almost each and every country has a constitution. Some of the countries have written constitution, some of the countries have oral constitution, but each and every country has certain rules and regulations which are followed by each and every citizen of the country. In your chapter, first of all, little bit introduction is given, and that is about a game of football. It is mentioned that if you want to play football in a proper manner without any kind of fights and issues, then there are certain rules that you cannot touch the football with your hand. There should be one goalkeeper whose duty is who can touch the football with the hand. So each and every game has certain rules, and that has to be played according to that only. Similarly, all societies also have their rules, and these societies are governed by these rules, and whenever these rules are not followed, there can be certain issues and conflicts in the society. You know, if we take example, there can be certain big societies, large societies, where you know different kind of people are living, belonging to different communities, different religions, and they need certain rules upon which each and everyone can agree without any kind of issues and without any kind of fights. So this way, that society will be governed very smoothly without any kind of troubles. So these rules which govern a country, these can be in written form or in oral form, these rules are known as constitution. Or we can define constitution as these are the laws to govern a land, or these are the laws to govern a country. In 6th and 7th standard, you read about Indian Constitution. Have you ever wondered that how it was written and by whom it was written? So in this chapter, we are going to discuss this, how it was written and who was the writer of the Constitution. Was it really Bhimrao Ambedkar, whom we consider the father of Indian Constitution, or there were certain other people also who were engaged in the task of writing the constitution? So here the question arises, why do we need a constitution? Can't we survive without a constitution? No, we can't. A country can't be governed smoothly without a written constitution. So most of the countries in this world have their constitutions, and all democratic countries are likely to have constitution for sure, because in democratic countries people elect their representatives and then they govern the country on behalf of them. So they need certain rules which they can follow and which they can implement for the progress of the country. So purpose of the constitution is, first of all, it lays certain ideals which type of country we want. That first, suppose India got independent from the Britishers, and then now we should know that now which kind of country we want to live in, and there should be certain rules and regulations which will form that type of nation. So it lays certain ideals which tell the type of the country we want to live in. Second point is, it tells what the fundamental nature of our society is. What kind of society we will be living in? Will it be a secular society, or there will be communal riots, or how this society will be living in peace and harmony, or fighting against each other, or something like that. Constitution serves as a set of rules. A set of rule on which each and every citizen of country can agree happily without any kind of doubts. Like in a country, people belonging to different communities must be living. Some must be Hindus, Muslims, Christians, etc. So, but whatever rules are written in constitution, irrespective of religion that a person belongs to, each and every person abides by these rules, each and every person respects these rules. Constitution tells how the country should be governed. That is the most important point. So, here in your book, some basics about the demand of the written constitution were described, that it was Indian National Congress, leaders of those who were freedom fighters, they started demanding for a written constitution for India, and Britishers permitted them in 1946. So then a constituent assembly was formed, and this constituent assembly was responsible for writing the constitution of India, and there were more than 300 members, I think 365 were there in the beginning, but after the partition, some of the members went to Pakistan, and then there were 297 total members who wrote the constitution of India. And it took 2 years, 11 months and 18 days to write the constitution of India, which we feel that this is something very small document and it was written within nights. No, such a long time was taken for writing this constitution. In your book, then the Nepal struggle for democracy is described on the next page. In 1990, people's struggle established democracy in Nepal. Earlier, it was ruled by a king, but in 1990s, they were able to establish a democracy in Nepal, which lasted for 12 years. After 12 years, again, it changed into monarchy. But its constitution said that its final authority would be in the king. Means it is not a complete democratic country where final authority is in the king. In a democratic country, the final authority will be with the people. In 2002, King Gyanendra began controlling all the powers. He took help from army on grounds of Maoist uprising. These Maoist people, he said that they are trying to disturb the peace of the country. So, I need to take control of all the powers. So, on these grounds, he started controlling each and everything. Finally, he took over in February 2005. Finally, he declared himself as emperor. But it was not so easy to get this throne again. So, these Maoist people against whom he had used I want to take all powers in my hand because Maoists are creating problems in the country. So, these same Maoist people, they joined opposition parties and signed a 12-point agreement with them. And this was a signal that now Nepal is going to return to democracy. In 2006, this movement gained force. And finally, in April 2006, the king restored democracy and they wrote their constitution. Because the old constitution didn't reflect the ideals of what they wanted Nepal to be. So, in 2006, he himself restored, because he was forced by the rising demand of the people, King Gyanendra established democracy in Nepal. So, as any rule is changed in a game, then game will be played totally in a different manner. So, similarly, now Nepal got a new constitution in 2015, because now it had to be a democratic country. It had to shift from monarchy to democracy. Monarchy, where a king rules, king or queen rules. That is known as monarchy. Where people rule, that is known as democracy. Democracy is a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. Of the people, by the people, and for the people. That is democracy. So now Nepal had to be governed by the people, they are representatives. So in 2015 they wrote their new constitution, which defined all the powers of different organs of the government. The important purpose of any constitution is to define the political system, that how the polity of the country will be working. The previous constitution stated that the country would be ruled by the king. In Nepal's constitution, it was written that country would be ruled by the king. But now if it has become democracy, you think it will be ruled by the king? No, now it cannot be ruled by the king. In democratic countries, lays certain guidelines about decision making power. We elect our representative and give them powers, but they can misuse them. Here in your book they are trying to describe that it is a rule for any democratic country, that power will be given to the elected representatives. Power will be given to, like in our country we have MPs, members of parliament, which make laws for the country, MLAs which make laws for the state. So the power is given to these MPs, so in future they can misuse these powers and they can make wrong laws. So in constitution only something is written in such a way which works like safeguard, which works like a security of the rights of the people, which works like a check on the powers of these MPs or elected representatives. Otherwise it may lead to gross injustice and chaos in the society. If all the powers are given to the elected representatives and there is no one to control those powers, so if they start misusing, then there can be injustice in the society, there can be chaos in the society. Chaos means lawlessness. Lawlessness means there is no discipline, there is no peace, somebody is crying, somebody is laughing, somebody is doing crimes and nobody is there to stop. That is known as chaos. So constitution protects us always against such misuse of authority, that these elected representatives cannot work against the wishes of the people. Otherwise in democratic countries we will have again the elections and we will not give vote to these elected representatives, and then they will lose the power. Such safeguards are given in section which is known as fundamental rights. In our constitution there is one section which is known as fundamental rights. In it six fundamental rights are given, and these rights are always with the people. No one can snatch these rights from the people. In class 7th you had read about Om Prakash. He was a Dalit. Dalit means he was from some lower caste. Why Dalit word is used? Dalit means suppressed, who is tortured by others. So these people were known as Dalit earlier when they were so much tortured by people of upper caste. So he had been discriminated against, partiality was done against him. And you read even how constitution provides us equality, and it states that no one can be discriminated against on grounds of caste. Constitution has given us right to equality, and that right to equality states that each and everybody is equal in the society. And you cannot discriminate, you cannot do partiality with somebody in the name of caste or gender or religion or place of birth. You cannot do partiality that you are a male or female. You cannot do partiality that you belong to a different religion. You cannot do partiality that you are born in South India, in North India we will not respect you. Or you cannot say that you are born in North India, in South India we will not respect you. So constitution says that all are equal, whether he is male or female or of any caste or of any religion. Each and everybody has equal rights in our constitution. So and that equal rights is known as right to equality. In your book, there is one example given in, taking some example from a classroom. So, in a classroom, students want to play some game, outdoor game. Some of them want to play cricket and some of these students, they want to play basketball. So, there is a clash and then teacher plans to decide it by raising the hand. See, the teacher tells the students that raise your hands, those who want to play cricket. So many people raised, so many students raised their hands. Suppose there are 40 total students, out of them 25 raised, means they want to play cricket. Suppose they want to play cricket. 15 students, they didn't raise their hand. So, now teacher decides that okay, because majority says that we will play this game, so let's go for it. So, these 15 students now, their demand is not considered at all. So, they wanted that teacher should decide some other way, like we are also 15 students, we are also part of class and we didn't want to play this game, but now we are forced to play this game because majority of the students, they wanted to play. So, similar things can happen in democracy as well, because a democracy is a government which is based on the majority. Like majority of the people, they want some rule that can be imposed on the minority. Minority means people in less number. So, for this also in our constitution, there are certain safeguards so that, the minority cannot be ignored and minority's demands also should be fulfilled. And constitution also tries that a dominant and powerful group doesn't use its power against less powerful group. Like you must have seen in society, some powerful people start exploiting the poor one and the weak people. So constitution tries that it should not happen in the society, because if one powerful group will start torturing the group which is not powerful, then there can be unhealthy situation in the society and there can be fights, there can be certain issues, there will be then no peace in the society. In democratic societies where majority will keep deciding against the interest of the minorities, so then what will happen? These minorities one day they will revolt. And that revolt means there will be no peace. If there is no peace, there will be no prosperity and then country will not progress. Because it's a rule in every society, even in the past we have read in history that if somebody is powerful and somebody is in majority, then they are likely to do tyranny against the poor people. Tyranny means atyachar. So in society, tyranny is a very common thing, that powerful people can torture the poor one. And so constitution ensures that minorities are not excluded from what is available to the majority of the people. Means all the facilities are given to each and everyone equally, whether he is poor or whether he is rich. Even constitution tries to prevent inter-community domination as well as intra-community domination. This is very important to understand. Inter-community domination means that suppose there are three communities, Christians, Muslims, Hindus. If they are fighting against each other, if they are trying to dominate each other, if they are trying to suppress each other, this is known as inter-community domination. But if people of same community, suppose Hindus are there, and if in within Hinduism there are some poor people, there are some rich people, so if these rich Hindu are trying to suppress poor Hindu, this is known as intra-community domination, means domination of people by the people of same community, that is known as intra-community domination. Hope you have understood this inter-community and intra-community domination. The third reason why we need a constitution is that it protects us from ourselves. How can we harm ourselves? One example is given. Sometimes we may take wrong decisions because we are not so wise. We don't think maybe in such a proper manner, and we are not able to take right decisions. So this way, there are certain points in our constitution which do not allow to take wrong decision by us. Here one story is given in your book to explain this, that there is one girl, Shabnam. She has to revise her syllabus, but she wants to watch her favorite TV program as well, which was about to be telecasted on TV that night. Then she discusses her problem and mental situation with the family members, and after that it was decided by each and everyone, tonight nobody will watch TV program because she has to study. And if we will switch on TV, then she will not study, she also will watch with us. So everybody sacrificed their favorite program, and now she is very happy, and now she is revising her syllabus. You think this was right decision? If she had to work, she only should leave watching TV, but she forced each and everybody that you also don't have to watch TV. So similar can happen in society, similar can happen in country, in democracy. Like sometimes we feel that this decision is right, but it cannot be right for each and everyone. Here we may think that now so much corruption is there in democracy. In India, if you take example, like in some of the states, criminals who are in the jail, who are there, you know, sitting in the jail, but they are fighting in the elections. Sometimes we can question, why are they allowed to fight in the elections when they have charges of rape and murder? Then somebody will answer, oh, India is a democratic country, it gives each and everyone equal rights. So then you may think, no, then the democracy is very wrong thing, it should not be there. So then you may decide, okay, there should be a dictatorship, strong dictatorship, so that such things can be controlled. So, but you don't know that dictatorship is such a bad thing. You know what is dictatorship? Dictatorship means Tanashahi government. Like Hitler was there in Germany, he killed millions of people. So Tanashahi government is never considered a good type of government. But by mistake we may think that we need it, and we can even take steps for it. But here in your book it is mentioned that our constitution is written in such a good manner that we cannot take such wrong decision, because we cannot change the basic nature of our society, we cannot change the basic structure of Indian government. And basic structure of Indian government is that India is a democratic country, India is a republic country. So this is the basic nature of our government. LIC. So this is the basic nature of our government, and we cannot change it, we cannot convert it into dictatorship. So this way, constitution protects us against ourselves also. Let us discuss about key features of Indian constitution. Indian freedom fighters had learnt a lot during freedom struggle, because they were fighting against the Britishers, there they had to suffer a lot. So now they wanted to write a constitution for country which will protect the rights of each and everyone, which will solve all the problems of the country. They wanted, after independence, we will make our own rules for ourselves and we will follow them very sincerely. For that purpose, Constituent Assembly was appointed. You should know what is Constituent Assembly. Constituent Assembly was a body containing 297 total members. These members were nominated from different parts of the country, from different religions, from different regions, etc. So these people were there in our constituent assembly, and there was one person from Hisar also. His name was Pandit Thakur Das Bhargav. Pandit Thakur Das Bhargav. He was from Hisar, and there is one school in Hisar also in his name, that is known as Pandit Thakur Das Bhargav Senior Secondary School, something like that. So, because we live in Hisar, so I have mentioned about Hisar also. And it took almost 3 years to complete this constitution. And they had certain issues in their mind when they were writing this constitution. All these members, they had in their mind that India has so much diversity, it should be protected. India had faced so much turmoil of partition, because at the time of partition there were communal riots, dange, in which so many Hindus and so many Muslims were killed, even lakhs of people were killed in that, innocent people. So that also was going on in their mind. Even they had this issue of princely states in their mind. Princely states were small kingdoms which were in India at the time of independence. I think their number was 565. These princely states, small kingdoms were there. So because Britishers had given them freedom that either you can become part of Pakistan, you can become part of India, or you can remain independent country. So this was also a big issue when they were writing constitution, so they had to think about it also. So by taking these issues into consideration, they wrote Indian constitution. And they wrote such a constitution which respects diversity, which maintains India's unity also, and it reflects their concern for eradicating poverty. They knew that India has become so much poor because it has been exploited by the Britishers. So they made certain rules so that in future we can be able to remove poverty. We can do some social economic reforms, and with that help we will be able to remove poverty one day, and you can see result. Now condition of people in India is better. And it emphasizes the role of people in electing the representative. This is most important point in our constitution. This point means that they said that India will be a democratic country. Very simple. Because if we are electing a representative, they are governing the country, it means it is all about democratic country. So let us discuss its features now. First feature of Indian constitution which is described in your book is federalism. Federalism means that there are more than one levels of government in India. For example, first level is central government, where we can see prime minister and council of ministers. Then there is state government, this is the second level of the government, where we can see chief ministers and his ministers who are governing the state. Then third level is Panchayati Raj system. So all these three levels of government, they have been given separate powers. So this way we can say that India has some features of federalism, but we cannot say India is a complete federal country. India is a semi-federal country, because all features are not present in Indian system. All features of a federal country are not present. So India is a semi-federal country. There are three lists which are given in our Indian constitution. These lists are like union list, another is state list, and the third is concurrent list. Concurrent list. So whatever topics are written in union list, on that central government will make the laws. Whatever topics are written in state list, On these topics, state government will make the laws, and whatever topics are written in concurrent list, on these topics, both can make the laws. Means state also can make the laws, and central government also can make the laws. And if there is any clash between the laws passed by central and state government, then law passed by the central government will be accepted as final law. So all these three organs are given powers separately. It's not like that their powers have not been defined. These powers are defined in these three lists, that you can exercise your power on these topics. So this way we can say that we have a three-tier government system in our country. Three-tier government. And it is also written in our constitution very clearly how each of these levels of the government, how each of these tiers of the government, how it will get money. Like what kind of taxes can be collected by the central government, what kind of taxes can be collected by the state government. Now if you talk about GST, so if central government collects it, each and every state is given its share from the total GST, whatever money is collected by the center. So let's move ahead. Second feature of Indian constitution is parliamentary form of government. Parliamentary form of government means there will be one parliament, which will be the supreme lawmaking body of the country, and people will elect their representatives, and they will make laws. These representatives will make laws for the country. So Constitution of India guarantees universal adult suffrage for all citizens. Universal adult suffrage is also known as universal adult franchise. It means each and every citizen of India who is of 18 years of age or above. So each and everyone has right to vote irrespective of their caste, gender, religion or place. Like if you are born in India and if you have attained the age of 18, then you have this right to give vote. You can elect your representatives who will sit in the parliament and make laws for you. While making the constitution, the members of the Constituent Assembly felt that the freedom struggle had prepared the masses for universal adult suffrage. Means now you know what is the value of your vote, and they thought that now we are enough wise that we will use our right to vote very nicely, and we will be able to elect people who are good and who are wise and who can make better policies for the country. That this would help encourage a democratic mindset and break the clutches of traditional caste, class and gender hierarchies. Even these freedom fighters, they thought that if we will give right to vote to each and every person equally, then it will break this caste system, class system and gender system. Like earlier females were not given rights equal to male, lower caste people were not given equal rights. So now they thought that if we will give right to vote to each and everyone equally without taking care of caste, class and gender, so this will bring equality, and this will give them, you know, that idea of equality, and they will come out of this poor thinking or narrow thinking of casteism. This means that the people of India have a direct role in electing their representatives. Also, every citizen of the country, irrespective of his and her social background, can also contest elections. Each and every person who is born in India can contest elections for maybe Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha or state legislative assemblies, but the person should have certain qualifications. Like if you want to stand in the elections of Lok Sabha, for Lok Sabha you need 25 years of age, you should be citizen of India, you should have a sound mind, you should not be a bankrupt, then you can find elections of you can fight elections of Lok Sabha. For Rajya Sabha, age is 30. Rest of the things are similar, like you should be Indian citizen, you should have a sound mind, you should not be a bankrupt. So you, anyone, maybe he is of any caste or any religion, so they can fight election. This right is also given by Indian Constitution to each and everyone. These representatives are accountable to the people, means whosoever is elected by us, that person is responsible to us, a person is accountable to us, he has to answer us. When we ask that we had elected you, you did not make good policies for us, so we can ask him question. If the person is not doing well, then we next time we will not give him our vote. Next feature of Indian Constitution is separation of powers, that powers are separately given to each and every organ of the government. Like government has three organs. First is the legislature. Its work is to make the laws. Legislature makes laws for the country. And what is legislature in other words? That is parliament. Then the executive. This is the second organ of the government. Executive means here Prime Minister and Council of Ministers. Council of Ministers. They are known as the executive. This is the second organ of the government. The third organ of the government is the judiciary. Judiciary means all the courts, Supreme Court and other courts. All courts of India, they form judiciary. And they also, judiciary has been given separate rights and separate powers. They can decide about their issues. The executive also, its powers are separately given. They have been given the duty to implement the laws. So legislature makes laws, the executive implements the laws, and the judiciary protects the laws and protects people against any injustice. So all these three organs are given powers separately so that there should be no clashes of power between them. But you should note that that constitution has created a system of checks and balances. This is very important to understand by you people. System of checks and balances means that these three organs, suppose this is legislature, this is executive, and this is judiciary. So no doubt that these three organs have separate powers. They can decide about their issues, but none of these organs is given absolute powers. Like we say that legislature can make laws for the whole country, but if legislature will start making wrong laws which are against the interest of the people, then judiciary can stop. I mean, judiciary will work as a check on its powers, because Supreme Court has been given the right of judicial review. Under that, it can review any law passed by the parliament, and if it finds that this law is against the interest of the people, then Supreme Court can declare that law as null and void, means it will cancel that law. So then you may think then the judiciary is very powerful, can do anything. No, judiciary no doubt has independent powers, but judiciary also cannot take wrong decisions and cannot be absolute, because Chief Justice of India is appointed by President. So here it is there to keep a check on the powers of judiciary. Moreover, any decision passed by judiciary can be cancelled by the President. President is the head of the executive. So this way executive can control its powers. So then you will think, okay, then the executive is most powerful. It can make any policies for the country. But here I want to tell you, dear students, executive, all these ministers and prime minister, if they are not doing right things, if they are making wrong policies for the country, then legislature can pass one no confidence motion in the parliament. And if this motion is passed against any minister who has done any wrong thing or who has made any wrong policy, then if it is passed by these members of parliament, immediately that minister will be removed, and the whole ministers and prime minister, they also will be removed, and the government will fall immediately. So this way, these three organs, no doubt they have been given separate powers in their fields, but there is a system of checks and balances. So this balance is maintained that each and every organ will work properly in a perfect manner. And this is the beauty of Indian Constitution. Next feature of Indian Constitution is fundamental rights. In our Constitution, we have been given 6 fundamental rights. Fundamental rights are those basic rights which are equally given to each and every human being, irrespective of any caste, religion, creed, gender, etc. So, first right, fundamental right is right to equality. Second is, as per this right to equality, there are many certain points that we are equal before law. We have equal opportunities for getting any kind of job if we have qualified for it. We have equal rights to work. We have equal rights to be promoted. Right to freedom gives us different type of freedoms, like we can reside in any part of country. We can form associations. We can sit anywhere peacefully, discuss the issues, etc. We have freedom to speak. We have freedom to express ourselves. So these kind of freedoms are given under this right. Third is the right against exploitation. Under this, we cannot be exploited by anyone. No one can force us to work without wages. And so this protects us against any kind of exploitation by powerful people or by the government. Next fundamental right is right to freedom of religion. This right gives us right to practice, profess or preach any religion of our choice. And no one will be able to discriminate against us in the name of religion or on grounds of religion. Fifth fundamental right is right, cultural and educational rights. Under this right, minorities are given right to form their institutions, to establish their institution, to protect their culture and language, etc. Sixth fundamental right is right to constitutional remedies. This is the most important fundamental right. It protects all these 5 rights, because if somebody has snatched your right, then you can go to court under this 6th right. Right to constitutional remedies means, treatment. Constitution means our constitution, samvidhan, that will give you proper cure of your problems, means that will enforce your fundamental rights back to you if somebody has tried to snatch these fundamental rights. And the section of the fundamental rights is described as conscience of Indian Constitution. Conscience means chetna. So it is believed that fundamental rights are only the soul of Indian Constitution. Colonial rule had created a certain suspicion of the state. Like sometimes we can see, we have seen during that colonial rule that government was not taking proper care of the needs of the people. So now people had doubt in their mind that sometimes the state or the government can become absolute and they can make such policies which are against the people. So our freedom fighters, they wanted to ensure that a set of written rights would guard against the misuse of state power. So when India is independent, They thought that we will add these fundamental rights to our constitution, so that each and every government will have to provide these rights to people of the country. So these rights protect citizens against any arbitrary and absolute power by the state. Here arbitrary means manmani. Absolute is also that kind of tanashahi. So, government cannot do this tanashahi and manmani against people because constitution has given us these fundamental rights which cannot be taken by any person. Even these cannot be taken by any government, any minister or president of India. The constitution thus guarantees the rights of individuals against the state as well as against any other individuals, that we have to have these fundamental rights and no one has the power to snatch these fundamental rights from us. Moreover, other than this, there were certain minority communities. Minority community means people who are in less number. Suppose Christians are in less number. Christians, so they will be known as minority. If Muslims are in less number, they will be known as minority. So Hindus are in more number, Hindus are in majority community. So some people of minority community, they also expressed that we also should be protected because in future we can be tortured by powerful people. So the constitution guarantees the rights of minorities against the majority, that majority cannot torture minority. Dr. Ambedkar said that fundamental rights are having two types of objective, two types of aims. The first aim is that every citizen should have the position that they can claim these fundamental rights. And second purpose of this is that, second objective is that these rights must be binding upon every authority that has got the power to make the laws. Means people also can claim these rights, and every person who has been elected as MP or as Prime Minister or as President, that person also has to follow these instructions which are written in Constitution, and that person has to provide these fundamental rights to people. In addition to these fundamental rights, the Constitution also has a section called Directive Principles of State Policy. These directive principles of state policy, these are like directions to state governments. Directions to state governments, like government of Haryana, government of Punjab and such other states. So whatever is written under this section, that is for the governments. But these directive principles are non-justiciable. Fundamental rights are justiciable. That if somebody is not giving you your fundamental rights, you can go to court. But if directive principles are not followed by state governments, then you cannot go to court. Then you will think, then what is the use of these directive principles if you cannot go to court when government is not following? The benefit of these directive principles is that they help us to know that which government is, state government is working properly. If state government is working as per these directions, it means we will think, okay, this is really good government, and next time also we will give them vote. But if any government is not following these directive principles, then we can decide that we will change this government. So these directive principles, they give us a measurement stick to measure the success of any state government or goodness of any state government. This section of directive principles was designed by the members of Constituent Assembly to ensure greater social and economic reforms. They thought that if we will write certain directions for state governments will try to improve the condition of the people by doing certain reforms in their states. And they thought that it will serve as guide to the independent Indian states to institute laws and policies that will help reducing the poverty of the people of the states. There is one activity given in your book that if certain things are happening in society, so which fundamental right has been taken away from that person? If a 13 years old child is working in a factory, so which fundamental right has been snatched from him? The fundamental right to education, right to education is being violated, because right to education tells that from 6 to 14 years, each and every child has right to free education. So if he is working in a factory, it means his right to education has been snatched by somebody. If a politician in one state decides to not allow laborers from other state to work in his state, so which right is violated? Right to equality, because he is not given equal treatment. If a group of people are not given permission to open a Telugu medium school in Kerala, so which right will be violated? Educational and cultural rights. Educational and cultural rights. Because under this educational and cultural right, minorities are given to open their schools and institutions to protect their culture. If द गवर्नमेंट डिसाइड्स नॉट टू प्रमोट एन ऑफिसर ऑफ आर्म्ड फोर्सेज फॉर बीइंग अ वुमन. सो विच राइट इज नेस्ट फ्रॉम हर? अगेन राइट टू इक्वालिटी. सो दिस वे देर आर सर्टेन एग्जाम्पल्स इन दिस एक्टिविटी दैट if we do this kind of things, then we are violating somebody's fundamental rights. The last important feature of our Indian constitution which is mentioned in this chapter is secularism. Secularism means that the state or the government has no official religion. Like in India, we have national language, we have national bird, we have national animal, we have a national anthem, we have national song, but we don't have any national religion. It means India is a secular country. Secular country is that country where all religions are treated equally. Each and every person has right to practice, profess and preach any religion of his choice. Every person is free to change his religion and every person is free to interpret his religion the way he wants. So this way, this is the last feature which is mentioned in this chapter, that India is a secular state. So as conclusion we can say that constitution plays a very very important role in laying out the ideals that we would like all citizens of the country to follow. Adhere to means follow, including the representatives that we elect to rule us. Indian constitution has been amended over the years to reflect new concerns of the polity. Here amended means Indian constitution has been changed. Certain changes has been done in our country, in our constitution. One example I can give. Earlier, right to property was a fundamental right. Right to property was a fundamental right. But then this was deleted from the fundamental rights, and then it is added in the list of legal rights. Legal rights. So if you want to have property, you have to give tax. But earlier, when it was a fundamental right, then there was no tax on the property. You can gather as much as wealth as much you want, but there will be no tax. But now it is not fundamental right, so we are paying tax if we have so much property. Often a major change in the constitution means a change in the fundamental nature of the country. So if you change any constitution, so similarly country also will be changed. For example, if you change democracy into monarchy, so full system will be changed. Then there will be no elections, there will be a ruler who will rule and make laws for the country. So we have seen this in case of Nepal. Earlier Nepal was a monarchy, then it was made a democratic country. So if it was made a democratic country, then it got a new constitution also, so that it can be governed properly as per the new system. Thank you. This is all from my side. So as I had promised that in the end of the video, I will tell you how to play the activity which I have shared in the description of the video. So to enjoy that activity, you have to first, like you are watching the video, then this kind of scene is in front of you. So at the bottom, right bottom of this video, this is the sign, this tick is there, you have to click here. When you will click on this link, then it will open like this in front of you. These are the links of the activities. Okay. If you click on any of these links, then this activity will open before you. You will click here on play. If you click on play, once more, it will ask you to click on play like this. Here you will click, then activity will start. So there will be one question, then there will be four choices. You will click the right one, then it will show your marks here. If you want to zoom this game, then you will click on this. If you click on this, it will become bigger in size. Sometimes activities of crossword puzzle. So if you find this crossword puzzle, then you have to search the words and terms which are given in the chapter, so that also you can enjoy. So hope it was helpful. and hope you have understood. If you have any doubts, you can write in the comment box. Thank you. May God bless.
Don't forget to subscribe to my channel and also press the bell icon to get the notifications about my latest videos.